If you have a signal on an electrical wire that consists of both AC and DC portions, would you know how to separate it? That's what we're going to talk about in this video, how to separate and combine AC and DC portions of a signal. Let's get started. Here I'm showing graphically what we need to do. We have two voltage sources, a DC source and an AC source, and the objective is to add them together. For instance, assume that the DC voltage source is just V1. Furthermore, assume that the AC voltage source is V0 sine omega t. Our target at the output is the sum, V1 plus V0 sine omega t. So what circuit are we going to place between the input and the output in order to achieve our objective? Let's try something out first. What if I just tied the wires together? Would that work? Well, no, it wouldn't work at all. It wouldn't work for the following reason. Imagine another scenario where I just had two DC sources, a 1-volt source and a 2-volt source. What if I just tied those together? Is the result 3 volts? No, the result is neither 3 volts nor is it 1 volt, 2 volt, or anywhere in between them. What I have is a mathematical impossibility. You might recall that when we define a voltage source in a circuit, what we're doing is saying at that node in the circuit, we have that particular voltage source. So right at this node, I've said this has to be 1 volt. Right at this node, I've said this has to be 2 volts. It therefore can't be anything other than those two, and it can't be those at the same time. So this is not possible. In reality, neither of these two voltage sources are perfect. Each one of these sources has a particular source impedance. I could definitely hook the sources together, but I wouldn't get the sum at the combination point. Sometimes current would flow around the loop in this direction, and sometimes current would flow around the loop in that direction. The direction of the current flow would depend on the AC source. When the AC source is higher than the DC source, it would flow one way, and when the AC source is lower than the DC source, then the current would flow in the other direction. You would always wind up at some kind of instantaneous average of the two voltage sources at the point where you're combining them together. That's not what we want here, is it? We want the sum. Let's try something else. I'm going to attach an inductor to the DC source, and I'm going to be attaching a capacitor to the AC source. What's nice about an inductor is that DC current can flow right through that inductor, but AC current can't. The opposite is true in a capacitor. An AC signal can pass right through a capacitor, but a DC signal can't. Let's recall why. The impedance of an inductor is given by J omega L, and omega is the frequency. A DC source or a DC signal is really like something with zero frequency. That means the impedance of an inductor is zero for a DC signal. It's like the inductor is not even there. The impedance of a capacitor, as you might recall, is 1 divided by J omega C. If the frequency is high enough, then the impedance gets smaller and smaller. That means that an AC signal with a high enough frequency can get right through that capacitor. A DC signal, though, will experience an infinite amount of impedance. The capacitor will completely block it. The DC signal going through this inductor can't go back into the AC source in the wrong direction through this capacitor. Likewise, the AC signal can go out through this capacitor towards the load, but it's unable to go back through that inductor into the DC source. This arrangement will work provided that the inductor and the capacitor are sized appropriately. You could think of it another way. The inductor and resistor form a low-pass filter. Only low-frequency signals, or DC in this case, can get through. You might refer to my video on one-pole filters if you're interested in recalling how to calculate the corner frequency of that filter. The capacitor and the resistor pair likewise form a high-pass filter. You can compare the corner frequency of the high-pass filter to the frequency of your AC source to make sure that the AC source can get through the filter. Inductors, however, are a bit inconvenient to use in circuits. So, in fact, this configuration is not as common as you might think. There's another more popular configuration that uses resistors instead of inductors. Let me show it to you because it has applications for transistor biasing. We're going to keep the capacitor in series with the AC source. In this scenario, we've more or less replaced that single inductor by a pair of resistors, R1 and R2. I'm going to go ahead and label the load resistor R sub L, and for the time being, I'm going to assume that the load resistor is large relative to R1 and R2. If the load resistor is large, it means that the voltage at this node is a simple fraction of V1. R1 and R2 in this case just form a voltage divider. I would typically have to include RL in the calculation if RL starts to become small enough to matter. The capacitor allows the signal from the AC source to be added to the DC signal. because of the resistor divider action created by R1 and R2, I have to change my output equation just a little bit. But as you can see, we still essentially have the sum. I would just need to increase my DC voltage source a little bit to compensate for the fact that we have resistors there. Let's now take a look at the output side of a circuit and consider the other scenario. What if we had a signal that was already a combination of AC and DC, and I just want to extract the AC portion of the signal? This is a lot easier and perhaps more straightforward to understand. I can just use a capacitor, can't I? If I label this R and C, these two components together form a high-pass filter. Because it's a high-pass filter, it blocks the DC. Therefore, I've extracted the AC, and my work here is done. We've now looked at both methods, how to combine AC and DC signals together, and how to extract just the AC portion of a signal. We're now ready to look at an important application, transistor biasing. In order to use a transistor as an amplifier, it's necessary to ensure that the transistor is in the forward active mode. For example, we don't want the transistor to be in cutoff, and we don't want the transistor to be in saturation either. In order to ensure that the transistor is not in cutoff, for example, we have to make sure that the base of the transistor is always high enough above ground so that the base emitter junction is always forward biased. We need a positive DC signal here at the base, don't we? If we have an AC signal, sometimes it's positive, but sometimes it drops down below ground. We're not going to be able to feed an AC signal directly into the base of a transistor because most of the time that would drive the transistor into cutoff. What we need is to combine this AC signal from our source with a DC bias point that ensures that the transistor will stay in the forward active mode all the time. You can see that we've used the combination that I've just gone over to combine AC and DC signals right here to the left of the base of the transistor. We're going to have to assume that the input impedance to the base of the transistor is large in order to estimate the voltage at the base. Typically, that's a very good approximation to reality. Indeed, we can say that the input impedance to the base of a transistor tends to be large. With bipolar transistors, I recommend choosing R1 and R2 values in the tens of kiloohm range. If you start to move up into the megaohm range for your choice of R1 and R2, then you start to approach the input impedance of the transistor. So you want to avoid values that are too large. Assuming then that the input impedance can be neglected in the calculation of the base voltage is just a fraction of the DC power supply voltage plus our AC signal, which goes right through the capacitor.
There's also a voltage divider set up by the source resistance R sub S, but we're going to ignore it for the time being.
If the capacitor is too small, then the signal is going to be attenuated a little bit, so that's something you have to be aware of. At the output side, what we want across our load resistor is also a pure AC signal. We don't want any DC signal attached to it or added to it. That's the function of this capacitor, to block any DC portion of the signal right there at the emitter. What is our emitter voltage in this scenario? Well, if it's a silicon bipolar transistor, we expect that voltage to be about 0.7 volts below the base voltage. Our load voltage is just going to be the AC portion of our emitter voltage. This is a DC signal, this is a DC signal, so we're just left with our source voltage. In a sense here, I've proven that in a well-designed common collector amplifier, we expect a gain of 1. In the next video, let's look at the common collector configuration in more detail. We'll do a full amplifier example, and we'll calculate the capacitor values too.